That's my lovely wife. I got married 7 months ago. And wives are wonderful things. They know when you start talking too much, they kind of can get it. That was a musical elbow tonight. It was really good. We're really happily married. We have the most wonderful time. You know, we're still on our honeymoon. It's only been 7 months, you know. So, no, it's really, marriage is the most wonderful thing. You know, I urge you all to do it if you got the right one. It's true. I mean, my mom told me before I got married, she said, "Steve, you know, there's one thing I want to ask you." She says, "I know you know that Kim's the right one," but she said, Kim, that's her name. She said, you know, she said, "There's one thing worse than being single." And I said, "What is it?" And she said, "That's wishing you were." So, you know, marriage is a great thing, but make sure you got the right one. We got engaged. It was a wonderful thing. We came into a little restaurant. We had our sweats on. And, you know, it was a place where you had to have a formal tux and a long dress to get in. And we said, "Oh, who cares?" So we walked in. The maitre d' was like, "Oh, we will sit you in the back here, sir." You know, they didn't want to take up too much space with us. And before we got to the restaurant, though, I had ordered a half a dozen long stem red roses to be put on our plate with a little card. Yeah. Oh, thank you. And what happened was the card said, "With these roses, I give you my love, but six is an imperfect number. I love you, Steve." And she says, "Oh, honey, that's really sweet, but are you just trying to be clever by saying six is an imperfect number?" And I said, "What kind?" And she goes, "Great, you know, let's eat." So we started in, and we started to eat. At the end of the meal, the waiter brought on over the table a little silver platter with a covering on it. And on the covering, he says, "Kim, this is for you. Please sit down. I want you to have this tonight." And so when she pulled off the covering, there was a single red rose with a diamond ring tied to it on the plate. And a little card said on it, "But seven is the perfect number. Will you marry me?" And she went, and we had the best time. Anyway, marriage is a wonderful thing. This is my lovely wife, and we hope 70 years from now, the Lord tarries that long, and I'm still singing contemporary Christian music. that we are still going to be together. We had it put on the back of the carriage that took us away from the church. Instead of putting "just married," we put down there "married for life," because that's what it is.
Amen.
The Lord has made a commitment to us. We're married for life. Honey, go right ahead now. I know you're dying to push the button back. This is called "Shake Me Away." Is it okay to dance a little bit?
So cynical, then I call to my Lord.
I just got back from a trip to Australia and the Philippines. And when we were there, we saw a lot of people give their hearts to the Lord. We had a chance to work out in the fields in the Philippines with people that their take-home pay is $75 American a month. If you can believe it, that's 70% of the income of this country. Christian musicians can relate very well to that country. But the wonderful thing is, even though with all the poverty, the people have everything when they have Jesus. You know, the Lord has not called us to be successful. He's called us to be faithful. You know, I love these guys sometimes that will tell me, Brother Steve, if you just give $100 to my ministry, God will give you $1,000 back. And I'm thinking, you know, where does it say stupid written on it? I mean, if that stuff really worked, why don't they give their $100 to the Lord? God will give them $1,000 back and they'll quit asking me for mine. The fact is, it doesn't work. The fact is, God is not a credit card. He is God. He is holy. And I love what Keith Green says. He wants not your money, he wants our lives. You know? And so it just has always occurred to me, everyone teaching prosperity is always in debt. You know? And I can't figure that out. Anyway, think about it. Remember, the church is not brick or mortar, it's a people. So the building means nothing. You know, it's better to have dirty carpeting and clean lives than clean carpeting and just a veneer over the people of God. You know? We need to know that. I'm convinced a Christian in a Jeep is no more precious than a Christian in a Rolls Royce. Uh-huh. Well, that went over good. I mean, that's not cutting down anybody who has wealth, because it's one thing to use it, it's another thing to misuse it. It's another thing to make it, another thing to misuse it. But here, when we were overseas, some people came up to me, and they always have this image of Americans as not needing anything and having it all together, so they thought they were going to disarm me a little bit. And they said, Steve, do you know who you look like? And I said, no. And they said, Meatloaf. y'all don't have to agree so readily. And another group came up and they said, no, man, it's not Meatloaf. And I said, who is it? And they said, it's Ozzy Osbourne. Yeah, it didn't light up my life either. And then another group came up on the plane, some stewardesses, and they said, can we have your autograph? I said, oh, I'd love to ask Vlad. And so I started signing this piece of paper. And I said, can I ask you a question? What album do you have? And they said, oh, you mean you sing too? This is too good. And I said, what do you mean I sing too? That's what I do. They said, aren't you that guy Roddy Piper on Championship Wrestling? I said, there. Some people, they came up, they were the first time, they said, Steve, you know, it's not Ozzy. And I said, well, God bless you, you know, thank you. And they said, but we've come up with a nickname for you. And I said, what is it? And they said, instead of calling you Ozzy Osbourne, we've nicknamed you Fuzzy Reborn. So anyway, but one of the best things that happened over there is I had a chance to sing in front of some bald-headed women. And they're called skinheads, and you know, Kojak I can handle, but I don't come from a bald-headed background, you know? And so it scared me a little bit. And I said, Lord, how in the ham and eggs can I share you with a bunch of bald-headed women? You know, I don't understand this. And all of a sudden, a verse out of the New Testament hit me there where Jesus was talking to the Pharisees. He says, don't you know what makes a person clean or unclean is not what they put into their stomach. He was rebuking them for saying that they were unholy by eating on the Sabbath. And I thought, you know, that makes sense. Not only is it not what you put into your stomach, it's not the color of your hair or the lack of it, you know, that makes you acceptable unto God. And so I thought, Lord, get their hearts tonight. Regardless of the hair, get their hearts. And I want you to know, at the end of that concert, we had over a dozen of those skinhead ladies that came down to accept Jesus as their Lord and Savior. I couldn't believe it. You know, he's greater than our appearances, our image, even the hardness of our heart. And so I told those ladies afterwards, I said, girls, I can hardly wait to come back a year from now and see how you're doing your faith as a sign of how your hair is growing back. You know? It'd be wonderful. Anyway, this is a song. We're here to talk about unborn children tonight, but any cause that would be against the Lord, boy, we need to speak out against. We need to speak for the Lord, but we need to defend the helpless and the widow and the orphan, the unborn child, as well as we need to go into our neighborhoods and simply love our neighbor. Jesus said, even handing a cup of cold water in my name can be really a powerful witness if it's done in my name. This is a song about really getting out of the pews and going out into the world and being a witness for him. It's a song I wrote about an old girlfriend of mine named Jane. This is called Lazy Jane. Sometimes when I'm in a church and I do these little steps, and is there some water around? Could you hold this for me? Thank you. Recently, and I said, Mom, how'd you like it? She says, oh, I love the parts where you talk. And so being people are probably saying, my gosh, you know, his throat's not healed tonight. I mean, he's better, but his throat's... This is how I sound all the time. Like I've swallowed broken glass or something. And I know that the Lord has given me this voice to encourage others to get involved in Christian music. I wish I could sing like Sandy Patty. You know? Or maybe Steve Green would be the better choice. No, but aren't you glad that the Lord uses the weak and insignificant, foolish things of the world? I'm going to read you something. I love the Bible. I use the King James Version. I can't understand the new language. Do you find that sometimes? I can't memorize the other. You do? God bless you. As we were saying before, moreover, the law entered that the offense might abound, but where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. That as sin hath reigned unto death, even so grace might reign through righteousness unto eternal life by Jesus Christ our Lord. Don't you ever get angry at Adam for taking a bite of that apple?
Yeah.
I really get angry, more so at Eve for listening to that serpent. And then Paul says here, he says, what shall we say then? Shall we continue to sin so that grace may abound? I'm just joking. He says, God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer in it? We are slaves either to death or to righteousness. The question is, are we slaves unto him? You know, the new cross of today will give you everything. Self-glorification, honor, prestige, popularity, prosperity. And the old cross demanded that a man, a woman, come and die. I was reading the other day in Fox's Book of Martyrs that every apostle, with the exception of two, and even our dear Lord, died violent deaths. Why? Because the world will hate us if we follow Jesus. Got a young believer saying amen in the back. I love it. And that's how we must come as little children, right? Weakness is a prerequisite for holiness. We must come completely abandoned, saying, you are our Father, please tell us, instruct us, teach us. We can do nothing apart from you. The old cross demands everything. As Bonhoeffer says, it's costly grace because it costs us our entire lives, but it's grace because it gives us the only true life. Looks like the boy's in trouble again. Living much too close to the edge of sin. He finds himself where he should not have been. Oh God, why is your peace so hard to find? And the answers to the questions that haunt my mind. Oh Lord, your ways are not like mine, and it pounds like a thunder within my breast. All of the anger of my humanness, I call you Lord, but I must confess I'm a stranger to your holiness, a stranger to your holiness. Can we really be what we were meant to be? Jesus' people, living by the Holy Spirit and living free. My heart longs to serve and wander so aimlessly. Oh Lord, you deserve heaven. cries of desperation as I see the wickedness of my ways. You alone are my salvation, and Lord, I've learned this one thing to be true: the closer I get to you, I see that I'm a stranger. I don't wanna be Lord with a fall. You're there with your forgiveness. You're there with your faithfulness. You're greater than the words I say. You're greater than my thoughts, which often get in my way. Looks like the boy's in trouble. Two men came to church one day. One was upstanding in the community. He had everything you'd want. He walked in. He took a seat in the front row. That was his seat. He fasted every week, tithed, helped the poor, defended everyone. And he came in the front and he said, Lord, thank you that you've given me the ability to tithe and to fast and all these things before you. Problem was, it just wasn't before God because everyone else was watching. And all of a sudden, this little guy walked in from the back. He was very poor. He couldn't afford shoes. His Levi's had big holes in them. His t-shirt was ripped. He smelled a little bit. He couldn't bathe for a long time. His hair was long and dirty, his face unshaven. And he sees what's going on down front, and he's just slipped in the back of the door, and he slips in, he's hid back there. And he looks up to heaven, almost embarrassingly, he says, God, I'm a sinner. I don't even belong in here. Right about then, this other man noticed that someone else was praying when he was praying. And he walked over to take a look at this man. This older man looks up to heaven and he says, God, thank you. I'm not like that. And Jesus finished his parable. The question is, which man's prayer was more valuable to God?
It pounds like a thunder within my breast, all of the anger of my humanness. I call you Lord, but I must confess, I'm a stranger to your holiness, a stranger to your holiness.
God's value system is different from ours. People fight every day on Wall Street for a little gold. What is God doing? He says the streets of heaven are made of gold. What man considers to be important, the Lord turns into asphalt. There was a time when people didn't worship things, they worshiped the Lord. They loved their families. And they didn't throw away their children either. Oh, God bless you. Be at peace. And our heaven just weeps. Jesus came to your door. We left him out on the streets. Little children today died of starvation. Don't pretend the job is done. 1,600 high school students today committed suicide. Don't pretend the job is done. And today, another 4,000 mothers aborted their young. Don't pretend the job is done. Solomon says this, Proverbs 31. He says, open thy mouth for the dumb, for the needy, in case of all such as are appointed to destruction. Open thy mouth and judge righteously and plead the cause of the poor, of the needy. Tonight we're here to plead the cause for ones that cannot plead for themselves, for the unborn. I know there's been so much talk in the media. And again, the problem isn't so much the abortion. The problem is maybe our morality that's so on the loose today that that's the only cure that people know for wiping out their past mistakes. It's not good to look into another man's jacuzzi, is it? It's not good to live outside God's boundaries It's a pleasure tonight for the next few minutes. I get the chance to get to know a very wonderful man who's a dear brother in the Lord this last 6 to 8 months. His name is Randy Terry, and he's a superman. He has a group called Operation Rescue that from time to time we're working with. He is a voice that is pleading the case of the unborn today. Not only is he pleading it, he's doing something about it. And before we take a break tonight, Randy has...